Rambo the Dropout was something of an idol to the surrealists, although they were rather keener on comfort, supplied by one patron more than any other, the English millionaire Edward James. Edward James spent his life and his money on a perpetual shopping trip round Europe buying art, and you can see his collection, including works by Picasso, Dali and Magritte, in an exhibition which has just opened this week in Brighton. But Edward James saw himself as a collaborator, and one of his projects was to translate the poetry of Salvador Dali.
Venus, Venus, we see your dreams, but we do not believe them.
Enter. Enter here, men of all times and races, victims of reality. You who have the thirst for dreams.
Thirst for dreams.
That crackly recording is of Dali's Dream of Venus, made to be played as part of his elaborate construction at the 1939 New York World Fair. He walked between a woman's giant open legs to get into this three-dimensional phantasmagoria in which live mermaids swam among surreal objects. James paid for this event with part of the fortune he inherited at the age of five. Born in 1907, he was sent to Eton and destined, it was hoped, for a career in Parliament. But at Oxford he rebelled, founding his own printing press to publish the poems of John Betjeman on alternating pink and blue sheets. The exhibition at Brighton's Museum and Gallery of Art follows his life from Eton to the jungles of Mexico, where he built his fabulous Baroque folly. The exhibition's curator is Sharon Michi Kutsumoko, who first became fascinated with James when, as a law student, she took a job sifting through some of his extraordinary archive.
Over the last about maybe 7 years, we've found thousands and thousands of suitcases and trunks of Edward James's materials. He wrapped everything in bundles of tissue paper, and you would open a trunk and you would start unwrapping these tissue papers, and you would think that as you unwrapped the entire ream of tissue paper, you'd come to some gem inside. But the way he did it is he actually wrapped it everything piece by piece. So he would take all of his correspondence from a lifetime, throw it up in the air, gather them up by handfuls as they fell randomly, and start wrapping them in tissue paper. So he'll put a piece of a letter here, wrap it in one piece of tissue paper, then he'd put a packet of sugar, then he'd wrap that up. And as you unwrap it, and these surprises started falling out, his old underwear and his socks and a piece of desiccated bread, then he'd have a drawing by Salvador Dali. But it was all without any sense of value. It wasn't that when you came to the very end, you all of a sudden discovered a Dali or Magritte or something the conventional world would think is important. And what it did is it forced you as an archivist to, it's robbed you of any conventional means of organizing things. And you had to almost join and become a participant in this very surreal experience.
After James left Oxford in 1929, he met and married the beautiful dancer Tilly Losh. In an effort to save the marriage, which quickly failed, he began to bankroll the ballets of Balanchine. He also paid for surrealist happenings, avant-garde plays, and worked with Brecht and Weill on The Seven Deadly Sins, danced by Losh and sung by Lotte Lenya.
Meine Schwester und ich stammen aus Louisiana. Die Wasser des Mississippi und der Monde fließen, wie sie aus den Liedern erfahren können.
The marriage to Losh ended in scandalous divorce, with James outraging English society by accusing Losh of adultery. But at this point, in 1934, James met Salvador Dali and became his avid patron. The exhibition in Brighton includes the famous lobster telephone which Dali designed for him.
Art history oftentimes creates quite a brouhaha over the creation of the lobster telephone, but the way it actually came about is that Salvador Dali, some friends, and Edward James were sitting on a bed eating lobster, and they were throwing the lobster shells to the side, and one happened to land on the telephone, and that was actually the way it started, was a lobster shell on the phone, and Edward, and it was actually Edward who said, let's try to create this. What better juxtaposition than an unusual juxtaposition than a lobster sitting on a telephone? He was very much a collaborator, and I think this is one thing that's often overlooked, because Edward James is often labeled. Once you say somebody is rich, then all of a sudden a lot of the things they do that are creative, especially if they're different, become eccentric. And once something becomes eccentric, that's a very value-laden term, and it diminishes what he may have really been trying to achieve. And I think if you read some of the archives, which we have displayed, the archives between Dalí, the archives between Edward James and Magritte, you could see that they're actually looking to Edward as a fellow collaborator, as someone with whom they could bounce ideas off of to try, and especially Magritte, trying to resolve certain problems. And he's relying on Edward James's eye, because Edward James had such a keen eye to help him resolve some of the problems he was having with his painting.
Sharon Michie-Kinsonoki. With me is the art historian Dawn Addes, who's written extensively on surrealism and has a chapter in the collection of essays accompanying the Brighton exhibition. Dawn, James was not just a patron to the surrealists, he was a collaborator. What exactly did he do?
James was very keen to be thought of as a creative man in his own right. He wanted to be a partner, in a sense, with those artists and those poets with whom he had the good luck to be a friend. And he did collaborate. I mean, he translated Dalí's poem on the Metamorphosis of Narcissus. He collaborated in a number of other ways in facilitating the construction of various objects and the sofa lips that Dalí and he probably invented together. He also had the extraordinarily difficult experience of trying to realize some of Dalí's more extraordinary dreams, like the dream of Venus at the New York World's Fair of 1939,
and where he stayed on.
Well, he paid off the builders. Yes. He paid for it. He had to make sure that it was still a kind of, at least in some way, a surrealist vision. But, I mean, he was also himself a poet and a writer. But unlike Rambo, of whom you were speaking earlier, who stopped perhaps at the right moment, James really did go on actually wanting to publish books. He did publish a number of books, but in a sense I think he never actually produced the work that he would have liked to have done.
Yes, it reads like rather poor Wordsworth to me, actually, for poetry.
There was extremely moving poems about Tilly Loche.
Yes. He didn't regard himself as a sort of card-carrying manifesto surrealist at all, did he? But there are aspects of the way that he lived his life that seem rather surreal. I mean, for example, the strange folly in Mexico.
Yes, I mean, I don't want to start bandying definitions of surrealism with you. Yes, in a sense, he had the freedom that was, brought to him by the fact that he was very wealthy, and that he had, he had the freedom to move around culturally, intellectually, and physically around the world, and he could try and realize some of his dreams, and he did set to work to build a very extraordinary half garden, half palace, fantasy building in Mexico, which is not unlike the Palais Ideal of the Facteur Cheval in France that was so admired by the surrealists. So I think, yes, I mean, he did have a very powerful imagination, which he could try to realise.
Mm. Well, he didn't collect to sell, but to satisfy an aesthetic, didn't he? What does his collection tell us about him?
Yes, I mean, he had, I think, the insight and the luck and the money to buy the most extraordinary collection of works by surrealists. He had a kind of contract with Dalí and with Magritte to buy more or less their whole output during a period in the late 30s. Dalí, I think he had really all the great works by Salvador Dalí from the 1936, 1930, 1940, really. He had the Metamorphosis of Narcissus, Impressions of Africa, Spain, and these are all paintings that have been gathered at this exhibition, and they do look spectacular. They look quite wonderful.
Dawn Addes, thank you very much indeed. The exhibition that you're speaking about is at the Brighton Museum and Art Gallery until July the 26th, and the accompanying book, A Surreal Life, which includes Dawn's essay, is published by the gallery in association with Philip Watson Publishers.